good coffee. So good evening, everyone. Thanks for being here, and thanks for having responded to our invitation to talk about the future of copyright. I'm pleased to have my colleague Oyin Odell with me. We are both professors at the law school here at Trinity, and we both deal with copyright-related issues in our teaching, in our research, in different ways. What we do in addition to teaching, to do academic work, we both work a lot on policy, in the sense that we recently work with government officers, with public institutions, also in public fora, in order to animate debates on the future of a body of law that is very, very contested, very, ideologically influenced in many ways, especially with the issue of digitization of content. As I, as we put in the description of the event, everything has become digital. Every piece of content these days can be easily circulated online, can be easily enjoyed on portable devices in a way that copying the work, the books, the music, the movies we enjoy is no longer relevant. These days what we are talking about is accessibility of content. The content we like, not only traditional content that is protected by copyright, but also technology, technological products. If you think of software, if you think of databases, if you think of collections of texts that can be easily mined by machines, all these things can be accessed in a rather ubiquitous way. And the copy, the format itself is no longer relevant because the subject matter of copyright has become very liquid, can be easily accessed. So the real issue today is how we can access creative works in a way that those who professionally work on creative products on and who are trained also to be professional creators. You should think of musicians, artists, you should think of writers, journalists, architects, photographers, yourself, I would say, as users of social media. You shouldn't forget that all what has been put, what is being put every day on social networks is by default protected by copyright. You might not be aware of that, or you might consider your creations not particularly worthy when it comes to protection, but all what is creative enough immediately and automatically gets protection under the law. And this is a kind of regulation that is still outdated. So what we will talk about and what we will ask you to comment upon is whether or not this body of law needs to be modernized and how. We will make references to the European level because we are going towards the creation of a digital single market. The idea is that Europe will have to become digitally, so when it comes to the internet, as united as possible. And the European Commission is working hard on enabling at digital level the same kind of integration that has pursued at physical level when it comes to the removal of barriers that restricted products from circulating without barriers within the common market. So this is what might happen in the coming years. If today you are still struggling when you want to sometimes when you want to access content on services that are made available on a website that is not targeted at your own country because there are restrictions, because the supplier of the service of the product doesn't want you to access that website from Ireland, the German or Italian website from Ireland. This is something that European institutions want to change in a way that the market, but also the sphere, the public sphere in which these works will have to be accessed and sold to a certain extent or made available for free, depending on the willingness of creators, this environment will have to become progressively European. On the other hand, I have the pleasure to have Oyn here, who's who was actively involved as chairman of the review commission, the Irish Copyright Review Commission, 2 years ago. We'll tell you more about the national layer of legislation, because, you know, at the moment we are not mature. Europe is not mature enough to unify this legislation to create a federal copyright statute. We don't have that. We will probably not have at that because it's very demanding. Copyright. You should consider the copyright entails cultural policy. It's not only market. It's not only commerce. It's not only trade. It's not only money. It's accessibility of all what has been produced or what is being produced by human intellect. So I leave the floor for a brief introduction to my colleague Oyn O'Dell, and I thank him very much for being here and having accepted my invitation to have this public talk together.
Thank you, Giuseppe. As he said, I was the chair of the Copyright Review Committee, which reported two years and a month ago. And our job was to make recommendations to the government under various headings, effectively to adapt copyright to the digital age. A parallel process had been commenced in the UK, and they reported while we were working. We picked up the baton, ran with it a little further, and then as we were reporting, another process was beginning in the European Union. Now, that process didn't result in any recommendations, but the new commission has decided to revisit the issue of copyright, and Brussels is a city of leaks, amongst sad other things at the moment, but a city of political leaks. A leak last week suggested that we should see some development in the first week in December on European copyright. I'm here to give you not so much a leak as an exclusive. There will be an Irish development in advance of that. Next week, probably next Thursday, a Trinity senator, Senator Sean Barrett, will introduce into the Senate a copyright amendment bill to adapt and implement the bill in the Copyright Review Committee report, making three changes as a consequence of developments that have happened since then. But apart from those three changes, effectively taking the bill in the Copyright Review Committee report and introducing it into the Senate. In part so that the work in the report doesn't go the way of previous reports for government of gathering electronic dust on an electronic shelf in a government department server, and in part to make an impact on, or at least have some influence on, or at least try and be part of the European debate. And that's what Giuseppe and I want to talk about today, the kinds of things that are happening in European and Irish copyright reform policy. And as Giuseppe said, they're on different levels, and they will feed off one from the other. In some small way, hopefully, the Irish voices will be heard in Brussels.
Don't you think that in many ways the work that you have been doing in Ireland could be regarded, if the process of amendment of current copyright law in Ireland goes well, don't you think that in light of these amendments, Irish law could be regarded as one of the most modern copyright legislation in Europe?
That's certainly what the government hoped when they commissioned us, and what we hoped when we reported. We called the report Modernizing Copyright because that's what we thought we were doing. And that's what we were hoping to do, and in particular to do it in as technologically neutral a way as possible. Part of the problem about copyright is that it tends to respond to the present. When it was authors scribbling on manuscripts, copyright dealt with the copies of the authors and their publishers. And according as different technologies came along, copyright, limping a little behind, accommodated the technologies. What we were hoping to do was to catch up with the technology and then be sufficiently neutral in our drafting that further developments would not necessarily have a systemic an impact on the copyright rules as the developments of copyright have had, the developments of technology have had in copyright over the last 15, 20 years or so.
But do you think that the fact that copyright was designed the way we have copyright these days, the fact that it was designed for a time when digitization was not, you know, was non-existing, has somehow slowed down in an artificial way the process of modernization, but there are responsibilities for that. There are interest groups that push towards like lack of adequate reform or what? Because, you know, in my experience, for instance, in Brussels, it has been very difficult to let stakeholders talk to each other. We live in an environment, in a digital environment, which, especially on these issues, which regards the ownership of content, basically, who can control access to content, okay? It's no longer an issue that regards creators, individual creators, authors, performers, and you know the old-fashioned publishers or broadcasters. This way, they still exist. We still have intermediaries. It's not true that the online environment reduced these intermediaries to a sort of peripheral or non-central position. But we have more stakeholders involved in this kind of businesses. If you think of telecoms, if you think of online intermediaries, Facebook, Google, Twitter, but in general, all content platforms. We have legislation in Europe, even for non-lawyers, it's easy to understand that Europe comes out with directives, and the member states have to comply with these directives. If directives are adopted and designed at a certain time, we have the two most important directives we have in Europe were adopted in respectively in 2000 and 2001, the so-called Electronic Commerce Directive and the Copyright Directive, 2001. 2001 in this digital era is means long time ago. And by the way, in order to adopt legislation, this is one of the most unfortunate things. The fact of adopting legislation in Europe takes a lot of time, which means that the legislation we adopted in 2000, 2001 was designed, was drafted, was conceived in the mid-90s. In the mid-90s, the online intermediaries barely existed, and most importantly, they don't perform the activities that they perform these days. So we will talk more about that. But I'm curious to ask him, since he had this mandate from the government. I've never had this privilege. I worked as a policy counsel, an independent counsel, but I never had this kind of mandate from a government. My question is, there are interest groups that want the situation to remain as it stands with no changes, or everyone agrees that some amendment is needed?
Okay, I'll say two things to that. The first thing is that in our review process, two of the most interesting letters submissions, both of which came in by letter, interestingly, that we got. One started off, Dear Committee, the system of copyright is perfect in every respect and does not need to be reformed, yours sincerely. It didn't even start, you know, thank you very much for this opportunity, really interesting that the government is doing this. We've got a long period of involvement. We are publishers or authors or copyright users, or I don't know. It started off, Dear Committee, the system of copyright is perfect in every respect and does not need to be amended. Another letter that came in around the same time read, it actually did have a preamble first paragraph, but the second paragraph was, and therefore I suggest that copyright ought to be abolished. Yours sincerely. So, you know, it's perfect, it needs to be abolished. Most of the submissions that we got were somewhere in between. And so the second point is that the submissions showed that whatever your stakeholder group, whatever your stakeholder interest, whether you are a creator or a rights holder, whether you are a collecting society or a broadcaster, whether you are an intermediary, whether you're an entrepreneur, whether you're a user, whether you're in the heritage gallery, library, archive, museum space. Copyright and digitization together had both challenges and opportunities. And our role was to balance all of the challenges and the opportunities. I don't think you could say, and we certainly didn't find, that there were obstructionists for the sake of obstruction. There were people who made submissions that there were aspects of the copyright regime that we shouldn't reform for various reasons, and we disagreed with them. And there were others who argued that we should do or not do something, and we disagreed with those. But yes, we did find, and this is the same as in Hargreaves, that there were a lot of interests, not necessarily vested interests, but a lot of interests around that six or eight sets of stakeholders, which were sufficiently organized to be able to make submissions and make submissions in a coordinated way. But we found that civil society, for the first time in the copyright debate, became as organized and made as many submissions as the other stakeholders, and that was interesting. We shook the tree, if you like. We went out to try and get submissions from beyond the usual suspects, and that broadened the range of inputs, and I think that certainly broadened the range of recommendations that we made. A set of recommendations, for example, that we might not have made had we not had user input related to the exceptions in respect of copyright. But similarly, we balanced recommendations that copyright exceptions in favor of users ought to be broadened with a range of recommendations in favor of rights holders and in favor of broadcasters and in favor of collecting societies, so that the overall balance, we hoped, was about the same.
So the occasion of this talk is, even though I didn't work for a government, I recently co-authored a study commissioned by the European Parliament on the review of copyright. You know, in Brussels, there is a perpetual dialogue between the Commission, which can be regarded as the government of Europe, and the Parliament, which is one of the lawmakers. And even though formally, when students study EU law, they study they learn that the Commission has a sort of monopoly over legislative proposals. In reality, the Commission never proposes new laws without having heard, without having tested the ideas the Commission has in mind in the Parliament, because it has to make it sure that sufficiently broad consensus exists in the Parliament. In these areas, what has become rather customary these days is, and it has also been put by the European Commission into the new ways of developing policies these days, is the technique of public consultation. The idea that the laws should no longer be conceived just by policymakers, but the ideas and input can be easily derived from the experience, the expertise of the stakeholders, of the civic society organizations. What is very difficult in my experience, and this is just one of the fields of the law in which this problem exists, is to distinguish the genuine contributions from depictions of like distorted reality that are aimed just at influencing, at lobbying public institutions. And copyright has become an extremely polarized area. The debate has been polarized very much, because there is no doubt that without a proper modernization of copyright, also without a proper and prompt response of the creative industry to the phenomenon of digitization, for almost a decade, copyright had to face a sort of crisis online, because on one hand, the works we liked, the works we wanted to access, initially it was music, then it was, you know, videos, were not easily accessible with the consent of the copyright holders. So there was a decade, more or less, probably less, between 1999, the Napster case that some of you might remember, the emergence of file sharing technologies, and then the development of what we call these days online stores, the appearance of iTunes. It was 2004, 2005.
iTunes was 2001. The first implementation of iTunes was 2001, but it was 2004 before they had what they felt was a sufficient body of content. So it took that 5 years, 1999, 2004.
There was a sort of limbo. Yeah. There was a limbo that actually triggered, in my view, an unfortunate response in the sense that the internet was widely regarded as a no copyright land, because on one hand, copyright was very strict. As Owen said, it was designed to be applied in non-digital environments. On the other hand, the creative industries didn't respond also technologically in a prompt way, in a way to, to be able to provide audiences with the same goods, the same products, the same works they were able to provide offline, so that, at some point online piracy became like the main channel through which internet users accessed copyright works. But what we have experienced recently, I don't know if you agree with me, an impressive process of so-called re-intermediation, in the sense that the internet these days is full of walled gardens. The economists like these kind of metaphors. Walled gardens means environments within which, if you allow me, also proprietary environments. If you think of the Apple stores, if you think of the vertical integration of computers with portable devices, the fact that when you use the iPhone, you act within a closed environment. In those environments, in those closed environments, copyright can be easily enforced because there is a controller. But until the emergence of iTunes, until the emergence of streaming services, users widely resorted to file sharing and peer-to-peer. They still do, but there has been a process of re-intermediation in the last probably 10 years, also with the emergence of YouTube, for instance, 2006, that has changed also the rules of the game in the sense that it raised new questions that Europe now is trying to target. For instance, whether or not we should have a pan-European, genuinely pan-European distribution of content online. Why should Romanian internet users be restricted from accessing, without having to hack technical measures, the content that the British or the Irish users are entitled to buy, if you think of Spotify, if you think of Netflix and other services. Do you think that this process of reintermediation changed a little bit also the substance of the debate and or not?
Yeah, two things there. The first is that the technology created problems, but the technology has also begun to create solutions. And it's very easy to have a moral panic or a moral scare about the impact of the technology. But business models emerge to accommodate them. So yeah, the walled gardens, the iTunes, the Spotify's, the integrated broadcasters, all the stuff that you get on the Sky Store, for example, or things like Amazon Prime and Netflix. So business models are emerging to deal with the challenges, and I think that that is a very likely practical solution to a lot of the problems. But one of the problems relating to the portability of content is that there are, depending on the country, between 3 and 5 licensing bodies per state. There are 28 member states. That's somewhere between 100 and 120 licensing bodies that might have to agree for the purposes of the portability of content, and they won't necessarily be licensing all of the content. You've got to bring in some of the big platforms and the big content producers as well. So one of the problems with portability of content relates to getting the necessary licenses. That's why iTunes is geolocated, national. Yeah, that's why we have a good Netflix, but not a particularly good Amazon Prime, because of the nature of the licenses. The first attempt of the Commission to deal with pan-European licensing ran into the ground. They had a consultation and then they didn't do anything. They're now conducting another consultation in the hope that they will come up with something for, if not a December, the December policy document, the more detail we'll see in February. So you need the technology to recognize the potential for the response, for the practical response. And you also need the legal environment to be right. And in the context of pan-European, single European market, if you like, a single digital market, the Commission has to get the underlying architecture of pan-European licenses right. And that's going to be hard simply because there are so many individual stakeholders that are built on national licensing systems. I don't think it's impossible, but I do think it would require a great deal of political will.
But do you think there is any value in preserving these national architectures? Can this national access to content in a naturally borderless environment? You might have heard recently about geo-blocking. Geo-blocking is basically describes all those measures that restrict you from Ireland to access, as I said before, services or content that are made available in another country. Initially, geo-blocking was really a blasphemy on the internet because, you know, internet was regarded as a genuinely borderless environment. Then, because of the restrictions that Owen referred to when it comes to licensing, whenever you think of copyright, you think that, you know, the existence of copyright entails the presence of someone who's given the power to say yes or no to your request of use. So if copyright is still national and we don't have a federal European copyright, it means that on a country by country basis, if you are a film producer, you are entitled to license your film rights in a different way in a different country. Also trying to maximize your profits, or just to try to license in the most profitable way, identifying different broadcasters or different intermediaries that, according to your strategy, can pursue distribution or a dissemination plan in the best way. This is what is happening. The problem is that there is the competition of unlawful sites and websites that make these works accessible anyway, right? So how would you approach this? Because doing the things the right way, if we still consider copyright a right thing, the fact of granting this sort of property right, sort of exclusive right, if we still consider this a good thing in order to protect the interest of the creators and also their personality, their rights to object to modifications of the work that they do not agree upon and so forth. If we still consider this exclusive right rule a good thing, and as you said, this national architectures, the existence of multiple actors make the licensing process, the clearance of rights, so difficult. Then piracy instead is technologically very efficient, very quick, and cool at the end, because everyone wants, if a TV series I don't like, I like very much, is not available legitimately in Italy, or if its disclosure, its release is very much postponed, I really don't want to wait and I access it through a rogue site. Or what do you think about that?
Okay, well, three things. First, as I said, business models are increasingly dealing with that problem. Major broadcasts in one jurisdiction are very often followed immediately in other jurisdictions so as to minimize the time for piracy. And releasing entire series in one go on things like Netflix and Amazon Prime reduces that possibility as well. So I think the technology will increasingly deal with a lot of the practical problems. I do think that there is space for national copyright rules and for national copyright collecting agencies. space for national copyright rules, because competition within the digital single market is still going to be necessary. France is going to want to say that it has a particular cultural view and it wants its copyright law to reflect that particular cultural view. Mm-hmm. Estonia has a very open attitude to the internet. It will want that its copyright law to reflect that. The Irish review was presented as taking one particular perspective within the market to try and attract certain kinds of business and entrepreneurs as a consequence. So I think that there will still be space for national copyright rules. As for national copyright collecting agencies, you're still going to need representation. You're still going to need copyright. You're still going to need collecting agencies, collecting societies, to represent the creators and to negotiate the terms of the licenses. What the Commission is going to have to do is to knock heads together so that negotiations can in fact result in pan-European licenses for the kind of content that we're talking about, as one of the options that broadcasters or users will be able to take advantage of.
So your answer is, if I understand correctly, is that copyright is still valuable and enforceable online, even though many commentators, especially in the last 10 years, have proposed the replacement of copyright with a remuneration right, mm-hmm. since we can't easily let the copyright owners, the owners of content, express their license smoothly for various reasons. Why don't we merely compensate them and we leave the internet users free to do what they want for non-commercial purposes in a way that even file sharing would be covered by this kind of principle? And someone said, you know, the creative industries would actually make more money because at the moment they deal with a huge portion of the distribution of content that is not compensated, is illegal, and you know, this shows that copyright cannot be enforced online. So you still believe that if we keep the exclusivity rule, the permission rule of copyright that has been so much criticized, we can let business models develop and we can consider piracy like a tolerable phenomenon?
I'm not sure that I ever want to tolerate illegality of any sort, whether it's digital copyright piracy or, you know, breaking the speed limit. There are two different things going on in the theory of copyright. One relates to the theory of the starving artist in the garret who needs to be remunerated for the work that he or she produces. On the other hand, the method of remuneration has created business models that are removed from the theory of copyright. And those arguments that you're talking about in the last 10 years would draw a strong line between those two patterns and just look at what is an appropriate business model, what is an appropriate remuneration, and not call it copyright. If we were starting again, then possibly we would think in these terms. How do we protect what the artist wants to protect? How do we reward the creator as a creator on one side of the line, and on the other side of the line, what are the legal structures that are necessary for creative industries? But we're not starting from a greenfield site. We are starting from copyright rules that have an awful lot of competing interests. We identified the various stakeholders earlier. And I think the best that we can do is to get the balance right within that. So I don't think we can legitimately rip it up and start again.
Before opening up the floor for questions and for comments that you might have, there are two talking points that I put in here on my piece of paper. One is concerns the justification for copyright. You know, you often hear that copyright is getting discredited because the individual authors, the performers, do not get a sufficient reward from the existing system. So it's, you know, you hear very often copyright exists to the benefit of large corporations, media conglomerates, but not to the benefit of the writer, of the composer, of the software developer, individually considered. What do you think about that? Because in Europe at the moment, one of the main problems we had to work on in developing this study for the European Parliament, especially upon request of the left-wing groups, the Socialists and Democrats and all other lefty members of the Parliament, was, should we consider the idea of reserving by law a portion of the revenues for the authors and the performers? So those parties that contractually are normally very weak and in many ways and very often end up relinquishing their rights or giving their rights away for a reasonably small amount of money. What do you think about this, and how do you think policymakers could intervene? Do you think that this element of rigidity, so having to reserve a portion of the revenues, is something that would actually, in a way, labor law sometimes intervenes in contracting?
Taking your questions in reverse order, the idea of a remuneration first. This is a big idea in the Baltic states, in Poland, effectively in the accession states. This has been a big conversation or a big part of what they are bringing to the table in the conversation. It would require major surgery to the InfoSoc directive, but that is not itself a reason not to do it. I think I have real problems with additional levies of any sort. I think that levies are effectively a tax that will deaden whatever it is that you're trying to do, whether it's a levy on recording media, for example, or whether it is taken out of a set of profits and transferred. It is an impact on the market that I find very difficult to justify. So I can see where it's coming from. I haven't been convinced by the argument, basically because I think that it is an indirect tax and hard to justify. As for the first half of your question, it was effectively picking up on the point I was making about copyright trying to do an awful lot of things, and in an ideal world, if we were dividing it up and starting again, then yes, we could include things like a remuneration as compensation for damage or use. But I don't think that we are in an ideal world in this respect. The horrible phrase that was part of the Irish political discourse 3 years ago, we are where we are, that is still true when it comes to copyright. Copyright contains a whole series of compromises over the last 200 years or so, and all we can do is try and ensure that the next compromise is the least worst that we can get.
Considering that we are a few hundreds meters away from the headquarters of remarkable online intermediaries, one of the questions I have for you and also for the audience is, and it seems to be one of the crucial questions that the policymakers will have to address in the near future, is the role of online intermediaries in facilitating the functioning of markets for content, and also in compensating somehow the content that they host on their platforms, very often because of the activities of the users. I put in my talking point, the last one before opening up the floor, is there a problem of free riding posed by the fact that the online intermediaries such as YouTube and Facebook do not pay, or at least do not pay entirely, license fees for the content that they make available through their user pages? The sense that, you know, whenever you share a piece of content online, you no longer share it with a few friends, you might share it potentially with hundreds or thousands of people, while, you know, embedding a video that you take from a web page and you incorporate that video into your Facebook wall, or you you are a YouTube user and you upload a video without having the right to do so. Don't forget that every time you use a social media platform, you undertake promises while subscribing to the service. And if you read carefully the terms of service of each of these platforms, Facebook and YouTube, you normally you are required not to publish, not to post anything without the permission of the right holder. So in theory, these platforms are designed to let you share what you create. So in theory, user-generated content, an expression that you might have heard, I'm sure, in principle, it refers to the content that is genuinely generated by the user who gets creative and becomes more than a passive user. So what do you think about the issue of free riding, of the lack of compensation of users on social networks?
Well, I think there are three things here. The first, I am reminded of a study which I read on the internet, so it must be true, where an American university undertook to examine the terms of service of the most popular websites online and concluded that if you actually sat down to read all of the terms of service of your most common, the ones you were most likely to be a member of, you wouldn't have enough life left to read all of the terms of service. Because they're written by lawyers, for lawyers, or by machines, for machines, but certainly not by people, for users. The three different legal issues are these. The first issue is the liability or otherwise of the intermediaries simply for the stuff that's sloshing through their machines. And you started off by talking about the e-commerce directive. One of the things that the e-commerce directive did in 2000 was to say that the intermediaries were not liable for the stuff sloshing through their machines unless they are complicit in it, unless they are part of it. So that allows them to build the infrastructure without being liable for the content on the infrastructure. The second point is the YouTube example of, you know, all of the material that people are uploading, and on part of the terms of service they have undertaken that they are not infringing copyright, that they have copyright, or that it's copyright free, and they're leaving it up. But the way the legislation works is it says that if somebody who is the copyright holder notifies, then at that point the intermediary needs to do something about it. And YouTube have built a very impressive method of dealing with with this. But the legal problem is that the incentive is just to take it down. There isn't a legal, there isn't within that sufficient nuance to be able to engage with a content provider, so that this is one of the issues that the current platform's consultation in the EU is looking at. And the third problem is the free rider problem, which is, for example, Google. We all use Google News. The idea of the short link and the small snippet of text, or perhaps the in-frame image. In Germany and in Spain, there is a right that is not a copyright, it's an ancillary right. But because for political reasons, it's been cloaked in the language of copyright, so it's being called ancillary copyright, where the producers of the underlying content have persuaded the parliaments in Germany and in Spain to introduce legislation to require Google to pay a fee for each of the stories that it indexes or curates in this way. Google just simply stopped doing that in Spain rather than pay what it characterized as a tax. And in Germany has entered into negotiations with the big producers for compensation. And that is one of the issues that is currently being discussed in the parliament as well. I think that ultimately, this is another situation where the market is going to solve the problem rather than the law. There is only so much that the law can do to create business models. The market is going to have to generate them too.
But do you think that the liability exemption that you mentioned that derives from the Electronic Commerce Directive, from a directive that was adopted 15 years ago is too, has been interpreted too generously for the online platforms in a way that, you know, many observers think that a duty of cooperation should be created for the online intermediaries, for the owners of these very successful online platforms to help content owners get remunerated for their work.
On this I agree with you. The shorthand to describe it that emerged in the early 2000s was notice and takedown. YouTube got notice and they would immediately take it down so as to ensure that they weren't liable. It was relatively quickly followed by the argument that there ought to be a counter notice and putback procedure, and that became simply notice and action. And that's what the Commission is asking about. What should the actions be immediately after the notice? Do you have to take it down immediately? Can you investigate? Can you engage? Must you cooperate? And so on.
But you know that in Italy, for instance, or in Spain, two systems I'm rather familiar with, the problem with EU rules is that they always need to be implemented at national level. And sometimes this implementation, in spite of a relatively clear wording, is not the same. You know that in Italy, in Spain, this notice that allows the copyright owner to oblige legally YouTube or another intermediary to take the illegal content, the non-authorized content down, has been interpreted as a notice to be given through a judicial instrument like an injunction, which means that it's not an email to be notified to the online intermediary. You should, now there is in Italy an administrative remedy that is actionable before the communication authority, the telecommunications authority, which has, you know, raised an objective barrier for the copyright owners, also for the individual writer, for the composer, to notify and to oblige the aware online intermediary to take the content down. Because I think that in many ways this lack of clarity has helped a lot the intermediaries. Don't you think so? Because then, as you said, then the notification, I was impressed once. I worked for a while for the music industry, I have to confess that, for a year. And I was impressed for the majors of the music industry. And I was impressed by the number of people that they needed to hire, the association of the majors. Hired and still hires like dozens of people in London whose sole function, whose sole business is that of notifying the online intermediaries about infringements and in ways that normally are automatic. There are software developers, there are engineers, and they had to hire dozens of people, sometimes hundreds of people, just for the sole purpose of notifying intermediaries. In those jurisdictions where the notice can be sent informally, because as I told you, in a few jurisdictions, which are also big markets, if you think of Spain and Italy, these notifications do not work. Google, in a rather autonomous way, decided on a pan-European basis, or an international basis, to react, to respond to these notices anyway. So going beyond the requirements that the law created, so in a rather altruistic way, in the sense that they said we have to respond to the same complaints in the same way on a cross-border basis. We can't really behave in a different way in Italy and Spain, even though those countries have a more heavy way of interpreting the notice and takedown mechanism.
Well, unfortunately, the Irish legislation, in this respect, the implementing legislation is actually rather clear, and it would preclude the Spain-Italy interpretation. There are lots of implementations of European copyright law in Ireland that are unclear, but this isn't one of them. The Google headquarters not too far from here. It sounds very sexy to say you're working in Google, and you know, If Google is watching, hey, you know, I'd be very happy to, but not this job, the job I'm about to describe. A very large number of people working in Google are actually the eyeballs at the other side of those complaints. A lot of it is automatic, but some of it actually requires eyeballs, and some of it requires engagement. And Google already has a great deal of its actual on the ground workforce doing this kind of engagement. And that's why they want the quickest possible response and the simplest possible response, and that's why takedown is almost always the easiest response. Counter notice and put back up, engagement and so on, that's going to require more people. Okay, so that might be good for Dublin. Google have to build another tower and put another couple of hundred people in there dealing with counter notice and put back up. But, they don't want to have to do that.
So now it's time to open up the floor for questions. So please raise your hands, and before making the questions, wait for the microphone to be handed to you, because we are the event is being streamed. So there are people following us from home. Please.
I was late, so apologies, but I didn't hear in the part that I heard. Any mention of advertisers. So for Mr. O'Dell, just in terms of the Commission's consideration of advertisers as stakeholders, I'd like to hear if you can share any thoughts on that, or the absence of a consideration of that. In the UK, this would be quite big in the IFPI reports. And for our Italian guest, I think you mentioned a world where all but commercial uses, so peer-to-peer uses of content, would be okay. But the reality is that, you know, with affiliate advertising and midstream or pre-stream advertising, the advertisers are really making a lot of money, yeah. Both in authorized and unauthorized settings. So I'd just like to hear something about the advertisers.
Shall we proceed on a question by question, or shall we ask them to know?
Well, let's take this because it's very niche. It wasn't an issue that came up in the copyright review process that I chaired. It just wasn't something that anybody brought to us, and therefore it wasn't something that we considered. So I can't say, oh yes, there's a, you know, Section 29 of our bill deals with either the protection of advertisers or the dealing with sort of, you know, pop-ups or whatever. I don't see that there is I'm open to be corrected and be happy for the follow-up, but I don't see that there is a peculiar copyright issue there. That there are lots of business model issues. Advertisers can be content creators, advertisers can be licensors, advertisers can be broadcasters, and copyright works in different ways in each of those contexts. But I don't see that there is a particular copyright reform that would make the life of advertisers easier or harder that is necessary to do.
Now, with regard to the proposal that is being made with regard to the legalization of file sharing, first of all, there are many, many different ways this proposal has been developed. I'm not particularly in favor of it, but at least in the most remarkable attempts to construe this kind of copyright exception, say, with copyright exception with a remuneration for the right holders, the idea would not be that of dismantling the existing business models and the exploitations that are made up at the moment. The idea would be that of legalizing an area, portion of the online distribution at the moment gets completely, you know, uncompensated. So I understand that, you know, in defining the scope of this kind of remuneration right vis-a-vis the file sharing phenomenon would be difficult also not to affect existing models also by advertisers. But what I can tell you about what is being heard in Brussels, and several online intermediaries were among the strongest proponents and endorsers of this solution. It has been found that in many cases on so-called rogue sites or pirate sites, many advertisers were doing business. So the idea is that at least in developing new enforcement measures online, the so-called follow the money approach should be implemented in a way that if you discourage, if you restrict advertisers from operating through websites that are structurally infringing websites for copyright owners, think of the Pirate Bay that was regarded as one of these rogue sites. If you block access to the money, to the advertising revenues for these unlawful intermediaries, you inevitably impact on their businesses and you block an important and relevant source of infringing materials. In this respect, advertisers are regarded as stakeholders in the sense that recently they were caught in many ways to be doing business with intermediaries that were regarded as large-scale copyright infringers. Here.
Thank you. Thanks very much for the interesting conversation. So I work with libraries in developing and transition economy countries. So I appreciated your comments in the introduction that access to digital content is not only about market access and access to commercial content. And we are concerned that that sometimes when the Commission talks about cross-border access and to content and pan-European distribution of content, licensed content, that they're thinking of, you know, online shopping and being able to watch a football game in another country. Whereas from the library and archive perspective, it's a lot more than that. It's getting access to content for the purposes of preservation and education and scholarship and so on. But my question is about what do you think or what do you see the role of the ECJ in developing European copyright law and policy? So we've had some interesting recent decisions in the library area, for example. There was an interesting case on the TU Darmstadt case that confirmed that libraries can digitize material in the library and make them available on dedicated terminals in the library, irrespective of whether a license is available from the rights holder or not. And, you know, would you, this could be seen that as a perhaps a way of the ECJ kind of loosening the straitjacket of European copyright rules, particularly in the absence of an open norm like a fair use type provision in European copyright law. And Poland, that just adopted a new copyright law last Friday, has legislated for the TU Darmstadt case, and it could be, as far as I know, the first European country that's done that. So I'd just be interested in your views on the role of the ECJ. Thank you.
Okay, two things. I'll take the ECJ. I'll just mention the other things first. If our report had been implemented, then we would have been the first, because we anticipated the Darmstadt decision in our recommendations around libraries. And we, all of the things that you talked about in terms of libraries and archives and formatting and access to content and so on, is dealt with in our recommendations. And in fact, the Commission, having backed away from dealing with those things, is now likely to do so, and hopefully in a way that is consistent with where you're coming from. As for the trajectory of the Court of Justice, its first couple of decisions on copyright were all very much on the other side of the line, if you like. It's only relatively recently that the Court has started to consider user rights as opposed to rights holder rights. It's only relatively recently that the Court has started to take an autonomous European conception of various copyright doctrines, and within that autonomous European conception of various copyright doctrines, taken one that is a bit more flexible than a lot of the national implementations would have allowed. But that is its second bite at the cherry. It could change direction again. A litigation strategy to expand rights is always a dangerous thing in any area, because the court might disagree with you, or even if it agrees with you, it might change its mind. Furthermore, there is an argument that is beginning to gather steam that the court is going too far. It is creating autonomous understandings of copyright doctrines in areas where the directives don't actually allow for that. And so the Darmstadt example is one where there is a big push in against the Commission to reverse it. It won't happen, but there is a push to reverse it. And if the court overreaches, and there are lots of cases where it has in the next 6 to 8 months plenty of opportunity to overreach, then that will create a political pushback at exactly the wrong time from the court's perspective, because the directive, there will be a directive before the end of next year probably. So what do I think? Well, it's interesting. It's always interesting. It gives me something to teach. You know, if the court keeps bringing up new decisions, then, you know, it you know, my students and I then have to work out what they mean. Politically, it's questionable.
Well, the Court of Justice is doing more than just interpreting the existing laws. And the people who are familiar with EU law understand easily that the Court of Justice over the decades has played a role that has been also political, especially in copyright. You have to consider the very first copyright directives were adopted in response to judgments of the Court of Justice. So this role is not a new role. But obviously in the digital environment, it's not coincidental the fact that the Court of Justice started playing a more active role in the last 5 or 7 years. Because this is my interpretation, with the development of technologies, with the change of habits by users, also by institutional users, by considering also the necessity of libraries of other cultural institutions to digitize their collections, also for purposes of preservation and so forth. The court found in the existing legislation some gaps.
Wiggle room.
Yeah. That it felt entitled to fill because they said this is the purpose of directives. Directives aim at enabling, you know, effective harmonization and effective mutual understanding of rules. So if this piece in the puzzle is missing, here it is. In certain cases, they did more than just interpreting. They really, for instance, with regard to the notion of parody, there was a the Deckman case with regard to the parody that was made of a politician by a right-wing magazine of Mr. Deckman, using a cartoon figure that was used in order to make a parody of the politician. And it was a non-authorized use. But we do have a parody exception under the directive that Owen mentioned, this Information Society Directive of 2001. But the directive doesn't say what parody is. So the Court of Justice allowed itself, in the absence of a definition, and lawyers know how much definitions matter, but there was no definition, and the Court of Justice somehow created or resorted to a certain notion that took from the legal culture of certain member states. This happened in several ways, in different areas of copyright.
Could I pick up on that before we go back for another question? There are advantages and disadvantages to that. A disadvantage is that once the court has said there is a European-wide conception of whatever the doctrine is, in this case parody, then that's it. The national member states don't have any space anymore to work out exactly what that might mean. And increasingly, the court is asserting European norms. And if they are more protective from your perspective, then that's going to be a welcome thing. But if they're a land grab from your perspective, then that's not going to be a particularly welcome thing. So they are taking things away from what is currently within the space of the member states. But they might also be handing it back. One of the ways they have found wriggle room is to say that the copyright directives have to be interpreted not just in their own terms, but having regard to other aspects of European law and to other countervailing charter rights, for example. And by pushing back the scope of the directive a little, it creates space within which national institutions can operate should they choose. So that by Europeanizing one space, they are creating their, you know, it's kind of like pulling the blanket that's slightly too small. By pulling it in one direction, it creates a space in the other. And that is the kind of space where national authorities could continue this competition of copyright rules if they wanted to take advantage of that space. But at the moment, they're waiting to see what will happen in Europe. So it's the court is playing a long game. It wants to be part of the conversation. It just doesn't want the conversation always to be in Brussels. It wants the Brussels institutions to listen to what's coming from Luxembourg. But it's not an unalloyed good.
Hi, thank you very much. Thank you very much for this talk. I just have two quick questions. I think that in the past we've seen examples of copyright holders being relatively scared of other advances in technology. I think there was cases of VCR recorders reportedly bringing down the cinema industry and things like that. Do you think that we have learned from these types of cases or from other cases where advances in technology have influenced the way users interact with the law or the way the law restricts something? And on top of that, how do you think we're now prepared for the next step in 10 years? As you said, in 2001, something that was drafted into or thought of in 1995 is now obsolete. And if we draft something now, will it be obsolete in 10 years? And how can we sort of legislate to stop that?
It'll be obsolete the day it's adopted. We won't have to wait 10 years. And that's just inevitable. Have the content industries, the creative industries, learned from the example that you gave of the VCR? I think probably not, for the following reason. The VCR is a great example of how copyright law in one jurisdiction was able to adapt and another jurisdiction didn't. The Sony Betamax was litigated against by the movie studios on the grounds that recording from television of the movies that were being shown on television was going to kill the movie industry. And that kind of time shifting was said to be an infringement nonetheless, of the 1976 Copyright Act in the US. Mm-hmm. And the Supreme Court held no. Something that the last questioner mentioned was that there is in US copyright law an additional flexibility, an additional exception, that if there are really good reasons, it's called fair use, but I really don't want to get into the details of fair use or whether fair use is a good title. If it doesn't have an impact on the existing market, and if there are really good reasons for it, then the court can recognize that a certain use is not an infringement. And the US Supreme Court in 1980 accepted that the VCR, that the Betamax was not an infringement. However, it took legislation outside of the US to come to that conclusion, that time shifting had to be specifically mentioned in the InfoSoc directive and in the Irish legislation before Europe caught up. So those are two different models here. Can you give a little safety valve to the courts, or must you always legislate? And if you don't build a safety valve into your legislation, then not only will it be obsolete immediately, but it will fall over. And you end up with situations like everybody in Ireland who had a VCR before 2001 and was recording from the television was a copyright infringer, which is, you know, anybody who is my age and older definitely will fall into that category. So I think that the VCR demonstrates exactly why the legislation, to ensure that it doesn't actually creak under its own obsolescence, needs to have some safety valve, some flexibility built in. And one of my big problems with the current European process is that the Commission, in its 2012-2014 process, set its face against that kind of flexibility. It has simply not said anything about it in the current stage of the process, but I think we can assume, therefore, that it's not going to do anything about it. But in my answer to the last question, I said the court has created some space for some flexibility. That's exactly the kind of space that national authorities could exploit. The UK chose not to. I think we could. I think we should. You will see the colour of that particular money in Senator Barrett's bill next week.
Just a quick comment on the issue of future-proof legislation. I fully agree with Owen. The comparison between Europe and the US, in my view, is not fair, because at the end, Europe has a big problem. First of all, it has this national dimension of copyright that restricts courts, French court, from having the same kind of attitude, from the same kind of approach that an Irish or a UK court would have. Not only an issue of different legislation, at least for certain aspects, but also a different attitude, I would say. Also a problem of legal culture that is different. And even the Court of Justice, just taking again the argument according to which the Court of Justice is doing more than just interpreting the law, the Court of Justice is not like the Supreme Court of the US. Also the way the national courts refer questions to the Court of Justice is a rather non-satisfactory way from the point of view of, you know, having precedence on the merits of the problems that would help having the same kind of judicial references that we have in the US when we talk to a case. We talk about a Court of Justice that clarifies in the abstract with a relatively small, by necessity, attention to the concrete facts of the case. So the Court of Justice instructs national courts on how to interpret EU laws, but then it's up to the national courts, which have a diverse understanding of copyright, of the rules in general, to settle the disputes. So I would say that for us, it's even more difficult than for our US colleagues to conceive future-proof legislation, because we do not have the flexibility they have, but we don't have also the uniformity that they are given, also because of the judicial system there, which is, you know, well structured and consistent, I would say. There was a question here? There. It's one question. We have like 9 more minutes left.
Thanks very much. Just a quick question regarding the future of copyright and the future of copyright terms. As a rule, copyright terms tend to just get longer and longer. I'd be interested if there are any examples where maybe they did actually take a step back. I don't know of any, but do either of you see how this might be addressed in the future? Because it does tend to be that more and more international sort of arrangements, agreements on copyright, the terms tend to creep forward or occasionally bound forward, and it does tend to be the person with the longest copyright term in the room saying, no, my one's definitely the best, we need to all extend it up to mine, and not many people are willing to say, no, we'll actually step back. Could that be an issue? And the second little question on that is, would it make any sense at all to differentiate between media types? Say maybe that length is okay for books, a better one, this would be better for movies, this would be better for software, or is that splintering just going to cause more chaos?
It's always hard to prove a negative, but I think I can be reasonably confident that there has been no example of a reduction in the copyright term. And yes, the incentive has always been to drive it forward. The current commission process is not looking at the copyright term. On the other hand, the international negotiations in things like the international trade negotiations between the US and Europe, between the US and Canada, between the US and the Pacific, and you can see the commonality there, which is the US. They are the one with the biggest copyright term in the room, and they're the ones who are saying, instead of life of the author plus 50 or 70 years, make it at least 90 years, because that's what ours is. I fail to see what the copyright as incentive model benefits from having an extension to the copyright term. It's only copyright as business model that justifies the extension of the copyright term, and then you have to make a business case. And I haven't heard in the context of TTIP, for example, a strong enough business case to justify extending the copyright term. As for splintering, given that the various kinds of media are converging in the digital environment, it would be very, very hard to do that as a matter of practicality. I suppose the only way you would do that is to is if you were able to say that certain kinds of content just loses its value after a certain amount of time, and what you want to do is to unlock the value in different ways by incentivizing other uses. And while that case is being made, that case is not yet being made convincingly.
Yes, I agree with what you said. The process of extension of copyright has been unfortunate in the sense that the U.S. ended up enacting in 1998 the Sonny-Bono Copyright Act, which was proposed by Sonny Bono, a Republican. In response to the extension by 20 years that was enacted in 1993 by the European Community. Because at that time, the European Community had the problem of having different terms of duration in the different member states. And it ended up opting for the longest one. That was the German one, if I'm not mistaken.
So
in harmonizing, it took just the longest ones. It's fascinating what you say with regard to the a differentiation in the term of protection for different media, for different types of work. In many ways, copyright protects in a rather different ways when it comes to concrete business models and licensing techniques, books, music. It's already quite diversified, the kind of protection, also the kind of business you make with a theater play rather than with a music song. The exploitation is already quite different, and also the way the businesses have developed their own strategies, their own techniques, is rather different. Now, sooner or later, we will have to cope with that, I think, because there will be an increasing demand from citizens, I think, with regard to free content, because we will probably realize that enforcing copyright is already quite demanding and costly, and so having a robust public domain will have to become part of the game. At the moment, just civic organizations or academics or universities or libraries speak about the public domain. The people, the average people, are not entirely aware yet of the value of the public domain, how much it might count also in the negotiations, in the law-making process that might lead one day to a reduction of the copyright term. I consider already a victory the fact that the in several jurisdictions, among the most recent attempts to extend the term of protection, I'm referring to the US when it comes to sound recordings, were rejected. Then obviously we have in Europe a story which runs contrary to what you are saying. In 2011, the term of protection for sound recordings was extended by 20 years. So no longer 50 years from the time of publication, now 70 years, which was regarded as a sort of subsidy to the recording industry. By the way, that measure was adopted, was made politically acceptable, just on condition that the recording artists, the musicians, got 20% of the additional revenue. That's regarded as an example of guaranteed compensation for individuals. That, is certainly a positive active in a story that is not entirely convincing. Probably last question before closing the
My apologies if this was answered already, I was in a bit late, but in the future of copyright, in the near future of copyright, can you see a consensus at the European level for the policy of graduated response systems in trying to attempt to mitigate copyright infringement? Or will it stay the same and based on the EU allowing nation state, not, domestic states to interpret it themselves?
First of all, graduate response is a system of warnings that was sent to the infringing, supposedly infringing user, in order, you know, to make him or her aware of the unlawful nature of non-authorized downloads and so forth. And it was concretely implemented in France by law.
Yeah. Okay. Three things. First, predictions are difficult, especially about the future. Okay. That's one of my best lines. I've stolen it from Yogi Berra or Niels Bohr or someone, maybe even George W. Bush. Secondly, the Court of Justice, one of the pending cases in the Court of Justice may very well answer that question for us and therefore preclude action by the Commission. But thirdly, the Commission wants to act on this. It's likely that it will set some sort of minimum standard that national implementations, national member states can then implement. Whether it can go to a full system of graduated response, three strikes, five strikes, seven strikes, whatever. I think it's unlikely because I don't think they'll get a consensus for for all of the detail. But I think some sort of minimum standard is likely and possible.
I think at the very end, the Commission, the policymakers in Europe will more easily target online intermediaries with stricter liability regimes, I think. At the very end, enforcement is probably the most contested aspect of copyright. If you look at how the European member states reacted in a sort of legislative vacuum, each of them, especially in those countries where piracy is a problem and online markets have not functioned well, or at least as well as they did here, for instance, or in the UK, each of them found an autonomous solution. I mentioned a few minutes ago the solution of the Italian telecommunications authority when it comes to the system of warnings sent by the authority upon request of the copyright holder, which is a sort of notice a takedown with the involvement of the an administrative authority, which is, a very, very specific solution that, probably will not be regarded as an example to follow.
And just to follow up, one of the reasons why any action on this respect at the Commission level is likely to be minimalist is that Brussels still remembers the riots on the streets against ACTA, which was an attempt to create that kind of response by an international treaty to which the European Union was proposing to add its signature. And when the Parliament, when that matter was before the European Parliament, there were literally riots on the streets from Paris to Warsaw, as a consequence of which it was withdrawn from the Parliament, and I think the Commission would be slow to go back there.
That's the end of our event, of our talk. Thank you very much for having been here, for having participated, and we hope we will have you in the next initiatives we will hold here at Trinity, and thanks so much. Thanks so much to the Science Gallery from our part. Thank you.